Last week, I wanted to tell you a little story to start with. Last week, I received a very special Facebook message. And it came from a girl called Kathy Rolfe. And she lives in Invercargill, and she wanted to tell me how she was worried that TY Smelter might close. Her grandfather helped to build that smelter, and her father works for a company that could be affected if TY Point shuts down. And she told me, the most horrible part of it is that people will lose their jobs and have no money for their families. Kathy's 12 years old, and she gets it. She really does get it, because job losses hurt. They affect families, they affect businesses, and they affect communities. And there are people like Kathy all over the country. In Huntly, where Solid Energy's cutting 120 jobs, Greymouth, where Spring Creek Mine is closing, Kawero, where the paper mill is shutting down, they're worried about the future of their communities. Because without jobs, communities are lost. And that's why I'm here today. I want to talk about jobs. I want to talk about good jobs, skilled jobs, jobs that pay well. Jobs that will keep our best and our brightest here in New Zealand. It's a lack of well-paid jobs that's sending 1,000 Kiwis a week to Australia for better wages. That's more than any other time in our history. And you'll probably remember John Key standing in 2008 in the Westpac Stadium in Wellington saying the number of people filling this stadium is equivalent to the number of people going off to Australia. Well, he would have to go to Eden Park now. That's the difference. He wouldn't be able to fit them all into the Westpac Stadium. And I'm constantly told by people that they are working harder and harder than they've ever worked before, but they just can't seem to get ahead or keep their head above water. And you know they're right, because over the last 3 years, the median wage has gone backwards by about $13 a week once you take into account the rising of prices. Meanwhile, same time as that, household incomes for the very top 10% have increased by $2,000 a year. So the gap between the rich and the rest of New Zealand has actually never been wider, and it's growing. And that's not right. Kiwis know, and Kiwis understand, that it's not just about a financial divide. It's about fairness and it's about opportunity. And it goes against that most basic of New Zealand values, that no matter where you're from, there'll be opportunities for you to make a better life. That's the most basic of our values as Kiwis. And when it comes to opportunities, that's all about jobs. There's no challenge more urgent than addressing the lack of decent jobs available, because jobs matter. And it's not just about earning enough to pay the bills. It's because jobs also say so much about you. Often when you meet somebody for the first time, one of the first things you'll ask them is, what do you do for a crust? So it's more than just a weekly wage. It's about recognising that what you choose to do with your life actually matters. It's through your job that you're able to realise your ambitions and give your kids a decent start. It's a sense of identity and a source of dignity. And that was the message I got from the Spring Creek miners the other day. They're proud of the work that they do, and they're rightfully proud of the families they're able to support and the communities they're able to support too. They built those communities through their hard work. I value hard work, the feeling of a job well done, and the life that it can lead to. These are Kiwi values. They're the values that made our standard of living one of the best in the world. And they're the values that build the opportunities for the future. And that's why Labour has always stood for jobs, never been anything different. It's why Labour fights for the opportunity for a decent job and not just any old job. And that's why the next Labour government, 2 and a bit years' time, will stand beside businesses stand beside businesses and workers and create jobs with better incomes. Everyone has a part to play in that. And actually, that includes the government. It actually includes the government. Because for a country of about 4 million people to compete against countries 10 or 100 times larger than us, the government actually has to be a player, not just standing on the sidelines being a spectator. And that's the real heart of the fundamental difference between National and Labour. That's where our two philosophies divide. So today there are two paths in front of us. One is the one that we've been walking for the last 4 years, and it's a path that accepts second best is good enough. New Zealand's decline rather than building a future. It's a path where Kiwis feel increasingly trapped in a job that doesn't pay enough, trapped by unexpected bills, and we all know what that feels like, trapped by a lack of opportunity and a stagnant economy. Prices keep going up, but for most New Zealanders, wages aren't keeping pace. And many of our kids certainly looking at my kids, I'm not sure that they'll ever be able to afford to buy a house. Instead, we're seeing them seek better opportunities in Australia. That's National's path. It's a path to fewer jobs, lower wages, and our kids living across the ditch. National's attitude is that we just have to accept this future. But, you know, we're 4 years on from the start of that global financial crisis. New Zealand wasn't hit as hard as other countries because actually, you know why? This is something that never gets out in the media quite enough. Because actually we were well prepared. Because the Labour government ran 9 years of surpluses and paid off government debt. Yeah. Despite what you hear, we actually brought unemployment to the lowest it's ever been in a whole generation, the lowest in the OECD. Created 250,000 jobs. Now, that's a target the government could set itself. So New Zealand should be starting to turn the corner now. Instead, things are getting tougher. John Key and his government are hands-off when they actually should be hands-on. Instead of focusing on jobs, they're focused on selling off New Zealand, our asset sales. They're happy to stand back and hope things get better. Well, I call that ostrich economics. You put your head in the sand and pretend there's no problem, and somehow that'll fix itself. It's disappointing when John Key said he would stop people leaving for Australia, but instead he set those new records. And it's disappointing that John Key promised a brighter future. When you ask yourself if you're better off than you were 4 years ago, I bet you'll have to answer, actually, no. And for me, that's not good enough. Absolutely not good enough. I want to take New Zealand down a very different path. A pathway that leads to a new economy that has higher wages and higher skills. One that's being about being a confident, proud New Zealander. Not one that makes excuses for why we're not doing so well. It's a path that recognises that you can't fix poverty without creating jobs. It's impossible. And you can't solve growing inequality without decent jobs. It's a path where the government gets alongside workers and our businesses and our heartland communities and together helps them grow. Where we're patriotic. That's a word people don't use very often, isn't it? It's an old-fashioned word, but it's a good word. It's where we're patriotic. We trust in our ability to get ahead, and we beat the odds as we've done in the past. To succeed, the government needs to be a partner, as I said before, not a player in the game, not a spectator. And that starts by getting the big picture right. We have to get off the path we're on at the moment. The path looks actually back over our shoulder 15 years for solutions, like the asset sales. That's what we were doing back in the 90s. That's not the solution for our future. And under my leadership, New Zealand will change. It will be forward-looking. We'll need to be bold. We'll need to tackle the big issues that are holding our economy back. Our policies will ensure that the high volatile dollar doesn't undermine the competitiveness of our exporters. We're going to give them the best possible opportunity to succeed. Look, you all know, we all know, we're a trading nation. We can only grow wealthy if we export. We don't do that, we're dead. That means an independent reserve bank that's given a wider mandate to support exporters and jobs and not just focus on inflation. And you might have noticed that inflation is at an all-time low at the moment. It's actually below 1%. So this is an ideal opportunity to actually do that. We'll pursue a pro-growth tax reform that includes a capital gains tax to take the pressure off house prices and ensure that people invest in businesses and not in the Auckland property market. And we'll have a research and development tax credit that rewards ingenuity and encourages innovation in our businesses. And that really applies to Christchurch here. We're going to expand KiwiSaver to ensure all New Zealanders have a retirement nest egg, but to invest the money, we're going to invest the money so that we save our best businesses, so we can invest in those best businesses so that they don't go offshore. We don't have that money at the moment. We'll make superannuation affordable for the long term so we can guarantee New Zealand super for all into the future, as well as ensuring that our education and our health needs are going to be paid for as well. Now, those are the policies that David Parker and David Cunliffe are at the forefront of now. David Cunliffe was in Scandinavia recently looking at the way that they do their economic development. David Parker has been talking to Joseph Stiglitz, Nobel laureate, the head of the IMF, getting their feed into what we're doing. They think we're right. That's the path they believe that we're going to go down. So we're pretty confident about this.
Good.
But I can tell you one thing, though. All of those policies that I mentioned, they're all opposed by National. They're all opposed by National. Not one of them is supported by National. But they're absolutely needed. And I can tell you, they're not easy calls. They're tough calls. And I take my hat off to Phil Goff last year for making some of those calls before the election. They're tough calls, but I'm prepared to make them as we go into government. Because these are issues, these are critical issues that can make a real difference to our economy, to make a real difference to our businesses and create those jobs we need. But we also have to take action on what will make an immediate difference to the lives of a lot of struggling New Zealanders. And let me outline some of those. Last week, the government announced it would cut the pay of apprentices to encourage more apprentices. Now, I don't even, you know, that can't be right, can it? Yeah, cut the pay to, actually it is. That's what they said. That's in fact exactly what they said. Well, guess what? That's nuts. That, if that doesn't chase more people across Australia, I don't know what will. And even with those record numbers fleeing for Australia, John Key believes that lower wages is the answer for the future. I've got an alternative. I'd rather get young people, young New Zealanders, off the dole and into apprenticeships. And we can easily do that for no cost by giving their dole payment to employers to subsidise these kids into apprenticeships and training. I want to see local youth transition services that have been undermined bolstered so we're linking the enthusiasm of those young New Zealanders to the opportunities we have. And I tell you what, 84,000 young people not in work and not in education, we have to work on that as a priority. I want the government to be patriotic. There's that word again. Patriotic. to make the most of the money that the government spends. At the moment, over 200 government agencies spend about $30 billion on goods and services, including infrastructure, every year. If we can change, by changing the way that the government buys those goods and services, we can create more opportunities for Kiwi businesses and young New Zealanders looking for a job. And let me give you an example of what I mean. Dunedin's Hillside Rail Workshops, they made train carriages to a very, very high standard. Kiwi Rail chose a Chinese company instead of backing that local business. That decision could see Hillside Workshops close, with over 120 people losing their jobs. More than 50 other companies in and around Dunedin and the South Island subcontract to Hillside. They provide components and bits and pieces. They also lost work. That cost families their livelihood, and our economy lost talent and skills that could take decades to build those skills back up again. You know, to add insult to injury, those carriages are now being repaired by Hillside Workshops because of the Chinese company didn't do such a crash hot job on them. So why can't we be patriotic and get behind New Zealand companies? Why can't we give some of those government contracts to our own businesses, create those jobs? Because that's what they're doing everywhere else. Looking over at the United States, President Obama brought in what he called the 25% rule. Unless a foreign company, is 25% cheaper making a product, the work should be contracted to a US company. So they keep the jobs inside the US. Australia has other checks for local contracting. So does Singapore. So does a lot of other countries as well. And that's why we'll ensure that government agencies contract New Zealand businesses wherever possible, to build the businesses, the jobs and the skills to make us a more prosperous nation. Labour will require government agencies to do a wider economic analysis of those major contracts to ensure that the taxpayer money, our taxpayer money, is actually working for our economy. We'll also introduce what we're calling a 1 in a million target for significant government contracts. That would mean that companies that are awarded major contracts have to take on one apprentice or one trainee for every $1 million contract it receives. And we can make a start in the construction sector and expand it into other sectors where it might create other opportunities for young Kiwis. We'll also look at following Australia's example and require tenderers to outline the use of New Zealand components and suppliers in every bid that they make to the government. And these changes, I think, and I believe, these changes will make a real difference right here in Christchurch. They will provide the apprenticeship opportunities for young Cantabrians looking to get ahead. In rebuilding Christchurch, we could build the workforce we'll need for the future. But you know, National is letting this fantastic opportunity just pass it by. It's set aside $42 million to help train Kiwis for the rebuild. 80% of that money is sitting there still untouched. That's a waste. A waste. And with 84,000 young New Zealanders not in training or work, something is not stacking up here. The latest estimates say that half of the 30,000 workers you will need for the rebuild of Christchurch here will be brought in from overseas. Migrant labour, it's an important part of our economy and it's needed. But once those migrants are here, they should have the same rights as anyone else. But we have a responsibility to New Zealanders who need work and skills. And I want to be confident that the rebuild isn't used as an opportunity to bring in workers prepared to work 12 hours a day, 7 days a week for a minimum wage, simply to undercut competitors. I'm not prepared to sit and prepared to watch New Zealand go down a path that ends up with builders or painters or decent jobs being paid the minimum wage instead of a proper wage that compensates them for their skill. And whether you're born in New Zealand or you come here to work, everyone deserves the opportunity to succeed. Low wages undermines that. We need to avoid being locked into this kind of what I call a downward spiral, where our skilled people go to Australia for better wages, where people are replaced by migrants who are paid less, which in turn sends more of our skilled workers to Australia. It's a sort of a downward spiral that we need to get out of. We see that in our fishing industry right now. Some of you might know about that. With foreign charter vessels, using cheap temporary labour, they drive down wages and conditions. We see it also in the aged care sector. As the skill gaps start to merge, they're filled by overseas workers working longer for less. It's going down, down, down. I want to make sure that employers wanting to bring in migrant workers are doing what they can to find or train Kiwis to do the job. It's really simple, really simple. We'd raise the threshold so that businesses needed to prove they've engaged with WINS and industry training organisations before they get the approval to bring in migrants. We'd require that Immigration New Zealand can consider the what we call the competitive impacts, particularly on wages and conditions. So it looks at wages and conditions and sees what's actually happening to them, whether they're going down or not, before it approves to bring in temporary workers. And I'd also like to see conditions about wages and working conditions attached to the employer's approval, so we can actually follow up. And where we need to require the employer to offer apprenticeships to New Zealanders as well. Look, I can tell you, New Zealanders want to work. They're crying out for the opportunities. The rebuild is the chance to give New Zealanders world-class skills and experience to build a career here in New Zealand rather than somewhere else. So we need to be patriotic. That's that word again. One word I want you to remember when we go out of here. Patriotic. We need to be patriotic because there is the only other option to what I've just described to you is a one-way ticket to Australia, and I'm simply not prepared to put up with that. Another critical step to putting us on a better path lies in reviving our manufacturing sector. Currently, it is in crisis. Even if John Key doesn't want to admit it, it is in crisis. Over the last 4 years, 40,000 jobs have been lost. Exports from the sector have gone backwards by 11%. And I can tell you, I'm not about to sit around and watch New Zealand's future lost to that ostrich economic inaction. No Western country, and this is something that Goran Ruse, an expert that came out here, confirmed to us just a few weeks ago. No Western country can prosper without a thriving manufacturing sector and the well-paid jobs and the quality exports that go with it. New Zealand can't prosper just on agriculture alone. As good as we are at it, and we're the world best, there's a ceiling to how much butter and beef and meat and milk you can take off our grass. So manufacturing is the key. It generates around 12% of our GDP, more than farm gate agriculture and tourism combined. It employs 11% of our workforce. That's more than agriculture, forestry and fishing combined. Amazing figures, aren't they, when you start to think about this. And for every manufacturing job, listen to this, every manufacturing job, 2 to 5 jobs are made outside of manufacturing for every one manufacturing job. So you can see why manufacturing is so important to the New Zealand economy. And that's why I announced, along with Russell Norman here and Winston Peters here, I can tell you, you feel like the meat in the sandwich when you're sitting between those two. We announced a parliamentary inquiry into manufacturing. And we're calling on people to find out ways that we can work together to lift manufacturing up. Now, the government refused to be part of that. It just simply refused to be part of that. We said, well, we'll go ahead anyway. and we'll do it without them. And it's reaching across parties for the benefit and for the good of New Zealand, and that's what we should be doing as parliamentarians. We've got a lot of very good, successful businesses in New Zealand, but too many of them, as you probably have heard, are being sold off overseas. In the last 10 years, 32 of New Zealand's biggest high-tech companies have been sold offshore. These are the companies that create the greatest number of high-paid jobs.
How are you
going to
top that?
Well, let me just finish first. We're losing some of our best ideas and our brightest hopes for growth because these companies aren't getting the support that they need. And a lot of them are based here in Christchurch. Christchurch is now becoming the centre for many of those high-tech companies to prosper. Our high-tech the top 100 high-tech companies, here's another statistic for you. Top 100 high-tech businesses generate $6.5 billion, 80% of that through exports. Most of it doesn't go away in containers. It goes away in little boxes or goes away through the internet. We need to grow these businesses and quadruple their number over the next 10 years. That's the goal. And for that to happen, they're going to need to have three things, because these are the three things that are missing at the moment. They're going to need capital, because many of them grow to a certain stage and they just can't get that next step, you know, across the line before they get to be, you know, to be self-sustaining. They're going to need to, and we'll announce some of the plans that we have, and this is something that David Cunliffe is working on right now. We need to improve businesses' access to export markets because many of these are small companies and they're working in niche markets, and we need to make sure that they get that opportunity over there. And we need to make sure that we have the leadership in those companies, because you start off with a small idea and it grows into a bigger and bigger in business. You need different types of expertise as those businesses grow so they don't fall over. So those are three things that we're working on right now to make sure that those companies succeed. Let me finish by saying this. Our future is not set in stone. And I'm not resigned to a future of less opportunity and of slow decline. The next Labour government in 2014 will fight back for a future of opportunities. It's time we got proud, time we got patriotic, it's time we backed New Zealand instead of taking our hands off the wheel. It's time we backed our workers, our businesses, and our communities. And it's time we made sure that young Kiwis like Kathy Rolfe don't lie awake at night worrying about what their dad's going to do about a job. Thank you very much.